spend time with the Lord. We're going to basically catch up with him if we hadn't studied with him all week long. So, you know, the Holy Spirit ministers to us. And this is just a moment to encourage one another. But the one scripture that struck me this morning, and of course I lost it. There it was. In Hosea 6:3, "Oh, that we might know the Lord. Let us press on to know him. He will respond to us as surely as the arrival of the dawn or the coming of rains in this early spring." He is always, always. He is always. He's eternal. And he is glorious and he is marvelous. And this is where we have come to enter into his gates this morning. We have our youth that are going to camp in the morning, and we want to pray over them. We have several special ministries in the next few weeks and some fundraisers and some fun things with the women and the girls. So just please take a moment and look over your bulletins and thankful for this body of Christ that works together and ministers to one another through these outreaches and special ministries. This morning is also BGMC. So again, it's so good to see you. I hope that you were able to celebrate the 4th of July with great victory and know that not only do we have free access to the Father and that he has set us free, Galatians 5:1, that we don't turn back to that bondage again, but that we have a free nation. And that there were many, many men and women that sacrificed their lives for that. And so we need to continue to honor them. So I just praise the Lord this morning for being able to be here. And just feel like if you have any need in prayer, make sure that you agree with someone. There is power in agreement. And he always hears us when we pray.
Amen. Are you awake this morning? Yes, they were tentative, yeah. Why don't you stand to your feet this morning? I got up here a little early today, and I was just sitting on a stool over here just worshiping the Lord. It is really cool. Little Heidi Fitzgerald is here. You don't recognize her, Lord. She doesn't look like, well, she's the young woman sitting here, just 15 years old, sitting at the front pew. But she said something this morning. She said, I miss this place. And, you know, sometimes we can think that this weekend we were at the ranch, and me and one of my grandsons we'd shot fireworks off again, and everybody had gone back to the house, and we're just, me and him are sitting in Chase Lounge. I said, we'll be up in a minute. And we just kind of sat there in the dark listening to the noise of the frogs and the crickets and looking up at the sky. And I was pointing out some shooting stars and satellites coming over, just sitting, not talking, just sitting there listening to the night sky, just listening to the night sounds and watching the sky. My grandson, he said, we don't have stars like this at home. I said, oh yeah, you do. I said, just the light blocks it out so you can't see it. I said, it's kind of like when you go to church. You know how the presence of God is so thick you can cut it with a knife, as my sister told me this morning. Just God is here. And when you leave, for some reason we think he's not here. He doesn't go with us, that he stays in this building. But guess what? He doesn't stay in this building. Amen. My Bible says he'll never leave me. He'll never forsake me. His presence is with you right now. Did you know that? Right now, he's with you. Come on, somebody say that with right now. Right now, he's with me. He's in me. So I was sitting back there on that chair, and I was just meditating on that conversation I had. And the Lord said something to me today that I think I shared it with Rhonda this morning, because I know that Rhonda has a need today, and she needed to hear this. But I think you may need to hear this as well. The Lord told me this morning, said, don't make wrong decisions because of desperation. Now, it's one thing to be desperate for God and then just to throw it, you know, just all care to the wind. But sometimes in desperation, you'll start reaching for answers. How many of you know what I'm talking about? The Lord said, desperation is an emotion that comes when the natural mind is out of answers. What a good place to be. What a good place to be. Are you desperate this morning? Well, then quit trying to fix things. Quit trying to make it happen. Amen. This is the time right now today to stand still and know that God's on the throne and He's working in our lives. Amen. Why don't you just grab the hand of a neighbor there next to you, and let's lift those hands and let's worship the God that's not out of answers. Lord, we may be out of answers today, but we know You're not. And so, Holy Spirit, right now, I thank You. Yeah, Father God, it's quite possibly we feel out of sorts and discombobulated because maybe I believe that we've entered into a new season. It's a new arena, that next level everybody's talking about. But Lord, wherever we are and whatever's going on in our hearts and our minds today, we know that You are with us. And so, Father God, for that we say thank You. Come on, just tell Him. Thank You, Lord, that Your presence is here. I've got the promise that Your presence will never leave me. You'll never forsake me. Lord Jesus, I thank You that today You are manifesting Your presence. You're manifesting Your glory. Lord, I ask You just to show up in this house in a big, big, big way. Thank You, Lord, for traveling mercies for all that are gone today. Some have gone and they're coming back. They're here today. Father God, all the travels during the summer season, Lord, we thank You that Your hand is upon us. You're protecting us. Lord Jesus, we give You great praise. Lord, I do pray over the Santiagos as they're in Mexico. Lord, I pray a hedge around them. And I thank You, Lord, for members of their church that are here this morning to celebrate with us. Lord, we love You and we're here to celebrate Your victory over death, hell, and the grave. We're here to celebrate Your victory over every demonic power. Lord, we thank You today that Jesus, You are victorious. And because our life is hidden with Christ in God, I'm no victim today. I am a victor because You won the battle. We love You and we give You great praise and thanksgiving for all of these things. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said a great big loud amen, amen. Amen. Today is BGMC Sunday. I guess are you going to come say something? Come say something, my brother.
Boys and Girls Mission Crusade. Boys and girls, how many of y'all got your buddy barrels or your funds? All right, won't y'all all come on out front here? Come on, boys and girls, let's come up front. Let's remember our missionaries. We have a lot of people that we support overseas and stuff like this, even in the United States. Some are Alpha, yeah, home missions, Chi Alpha, I was thinking about. Let's remember to support them today. BGMC, I like while everybody's standing, go ahead and dig out. And let's dig out the coins, dig out your bills, your checks, whatever. But it's to support the Lord. It's not for me and these girls, but for the Lord. And I think you already prayed and blessed it. So at this time, boys and girls, will y'all go on out there? Start pouring them coins in the buckets. We have been missing it a couple of months now. So I'm not sure if these buckets are going to be big enough to fill them all. If I have to, we'll use these baskets. But bring it on. Thank you very much. Boys and girls are going to go around and pick up the offering. So boys, please pick it up.
Hallelujah. And remember our tithe and offerings. We have baskets in the front, baskets in the back. We won't be receiving an offering. We got a song that these kids taught us in Vacation Bible School a few years back. Amen. It kind of goes like this. Every move I make, I make in You. You make me move, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in You. Y'all remember that? Every step I take in You. You are my way, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in You. Waves of mercy.
Waves of mercy. Waves of grace. Everywhere I look, I see Your face. Your love has captured me. Oh my God, this love, how can it be?
How many of you love His love? Hallelujah. We're going to have to get some help up here with the hand actions. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's do it again. Kids, do y'all remember this?
Every move I make in you. You make me new, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Every step I take in you. You on my way, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Waves of mercy, waves of grace. Everywhere I look, I see your face. Your love has captured me. Oh my God, this love, how can it be?
La 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 la.
La 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 la. La 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 la. La 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 la. La 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 la. La 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 la. La 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 la. La 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 la. Waves of mercy, waves of grace. Everywhere I look, I see your face. Your love has captured me. Oh my God, this love, how can it be?
Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your mercy. Come on. Come on, somebody thank God that his love is so great. His love is powerful. Woo! Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. The words are difficult, but stay with us.
La 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 la. 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 La 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 la.
All right, all right. You done, guys? I would ask if y'all remember the hand motions, but I'm not going to try that. Nobody out here. I almost saw a few people going, oh, wait, I remember those. Amen. Good morning. So glad you're here today. Hallelujah. All right, guys. Get up. Get up. How many of you know that Jesus is a rock? How many of you have found that he's been your rock? Anybody besides me? Am I the only one that knows he's a rock?
Where do I go?
Come on.
When there's no one else to turn to, where do I talk to?
Come on, put your hands together.
When no one wants to listen,
who do I lean on? Yeah.
When there's no foundation stable, I go to the rock. I know he's able. I go to the rock.
Come on.
I go to the rock of my salvation. Go to the stone that the builders rejected. Run to the mountain. The mountain stands by me.
When the earth all around me
sink in sand, across the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock.
Sing the second verse.
Where do I hide?
Come on.
Till the storms have all passed over, where do I run?
Oh,
when the winds of sorrow threaten,
is there refuge
in the time of tribulation?
When my soul needs consolation,
I go to the rock.
Oh, hallelujah.
I go to the rock of my salvation. Go to the stone that the builders rejected. Run to the mountain. The mountain stands by me.
When the earth all around me sinks in sand, across the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter,
when I need a friend, I go to the rock.
Sing, I go to the rock.
To the rock of my salvation,
go
to the stone that the builders rejected.
I run to the mountain,
the mountain stands by me.
When the
earth all around me is sinking sand, across the solid rock I stand. When I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the shelter. When I need a friend, when I need a shelter, when I need a friend, I go to the rock.
Hallelujah. Father, yes, we thank you that you are the rock. Yes. Amen. The church used to sing, Jesus is a rock in a weary land.
Yeah, he is.
How many of you know that that's the truth?
Amen.
Well, thank you, Walter, me and you.
Amen.
Jesus is a rock in a weary land. How many of you found that to be true? How many of you have run to him and you know, oh God, when I can't turn anywhere else, I can turn to him. If you walked in this room today looking for answers,
yes, Lord.
Isaiah Hinojosa is going to be preaching for us this morning. Can I tell you? He's not the answer.
Amen. Amen.
We're up here leading worship this morning. We're not your answer. This building is not your answer. But friends, we're going to point you to the one answer, and his name is what? What's his name? I said, what's his name? Why don't you cry out like blind Bartimaeus? Jesus!
Jesus!
Have mercy.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain when I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good, good. Oh, you are good, good.
Come on, is he good?
Oh, let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins and the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. You are good.
Yes.
Good. Oh, you are good.
You're
good.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
Oh, you are good.
Good.
Oh, you are good. Good. Never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You are good.
Somebody lift
your
hand.
Oh, yes, you are good.
So good.
Good.
So good.
Oh, yes, you are good.
Hallelujah.
Good. Oh,
you're never gonna let. You're
never gonna let. never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down.
I want you to tell the devil he's never gonna let me. Listen. He's never gonna let, he's never gonna let. So devil, you might as well get behind me, because my God will never let me down. Hallelujah. He's watching over his word in my life, and he's gonna perform it. He's gonna perform it, because he's good.
You are good.
Come on, church. Come on. Hallelujah. You gotta speak to that problem. My God is good. Church, to lift up a praise. Come on. Come on, lift up a praise to this God. My God is a good God. He's a good God. Yeah, yeah. Thank you for your goodness, Lord. Thank you for your goodness. Turn around and tell somebody how good he is. Come on. Come on, tell them. Come on, I said he's good. My God is good. Listen, when we come in this house, sometimes unbelief comes in with us. You know that? How do you get rid of that stuff? You got to permeate this atmosphere with the goodness of God. In the throne room, Isaiah looked up and he saw the angels flying around, and from every corner of the room, they were decreeing the holiness of God. Do you know that? In this room, I want you to begin to decree and declare, my God is good. My God is good to me, brother. My God has been good to me. He rescued me. He brought me out of a horrible pit. My God never gave up on me. He never let me down. Hallelujah. I might have let him down, but this God never let me down. Hallelujah. So I want you to combat the lies of the enemy. And I want you to tell that devil, I'm not giving you any room today. I'm drawing a line in the sand right here. And I'm going to stay on the right side of this thing. My God is a good, good God. Thank you, Jesus. We used to do this a lot. It goes like this. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand, and I want to be standing by your side. I'll get it. Holding your hand. So let your kingdom come. Let it live in me. This is my prayer. Yes. This we're going to do that again. Do that again. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand. Want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come. Let it live in me. This is my prayer.
Lord, we're praying in.
This is my plea. Let the worshipers
arise.
Come on, worshipers. Where are my worshipers?
Let the sons and the daughters sing.
Hallelujah.
I'm surrendering my all.
I surrender to the King. Again. worshipers arise. Come on.
Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King.
Come on, pick it up here.
Father, I hear it growing louder. The song of your redeemed, as the saints of every nation are awakening to sing. From our hearts there comes an anthem. Oh, hear the heavens ring. This is our song,
the song to our King. Arise, let the sons and daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all. Surrender to the King.
Sing it again.
Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King.
Let the worshipers
arise. Arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing.
Oh, Jesus.
I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King.
Come on, sing it this way. I don't know if it's here or not.
Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King.
Oh,
Jesus, you are my King.
Hallelujah.
Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King.
One more time.
Jesus, you are my King.
Last time.
Jesus, you are my King.
Let the worshipers arise.
Let the sons and the daughters sing.
I'm surrendering my all.
Hallelujah.
I surrender to the King.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother Pat came and shared with me that it was, I believe, Travis that took that sword and drew a line in the sand there at the Alamo. He said, everybody that's willing to give their life for Texas, come and stand on this side of the line. And it was Bowie, I believe it was, that was, he had been wounded already. He was in a bed and he told his men, he said, you carry me across that line. Come on. Friends, it's time for the church to get on one side or the other. Not have a foot in the world and a foot in the kingdom. Come on. I believe I found something worthy of my life. I believe I found something worthy of giving my life to, and that is this kingdom of Almighty God. He gave his life for me, and all he asked for me to do is to get to live for him. Amen. Everybody say, oh yeah, Pastor, I'll die for Jesus, but will you live for him? Come on, will you suffer the offense? Come on, will you live for him? Will you just stand up and say, God, I'm on your side? Amen. So this song is commanding, is issuing a challenge to the church. Let the worshipers arise. Let sons and daughters sing. Surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. So Father God, right now we do that. We surrender everything to you. Our lives. Lord, as we just celebrated the 4th, and I listened again to Paul Harvey talking about men that gave. They pledged their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor, Lord, to build this nation. Lord, we're building something greater than a nation or than a state. But Lord, we're building a kingdom that's going to live forever. So Holy Spirit, come in right now. Speak to every heart and every life in this house, Lord, and pull us across that line. In the mighty name of Jesus.
I love you.
I love you. I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go. My Savior, my closest friend.
Hallelujah.
I will worship
one more time,
you
just the voice,
until
just
the
say
very
it. Hallelujah.
End.
I love you.
I love you.
Come on, sing it loud.
I need you. Though my world may fall, I'll never let you go.
Come on back in.
My Savior, my closest friend, I will worship you until the very end.
Hallelujah. My God, my God, my God. Come on, just tell him in your own way right there. Just tell him in your own way. Jesus. Jesus. Come on. Come on, church. Listen. What is worship? Worship is the response to revelation. The Spirit of God has penetrated your heart, and God has revealed his great love for you. And he's opened up a door that you can enjoy freedom that was not possible in any other way. Amen. That should, it must prompt us just to abandon ourselves in his presence and his glory. My God, you're so wonderful. Jesus, come on, just whisper his name. Jesus. Jesus, you're so good. Hallelujah. Come on, just waves of his glory just washing in this place. Hallelujah. There's a cleansing that came when I gave my life to this man. He washed. Glory, 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 glory. Yes. Yes. Thank you, Father. Yeah, yeah.
The Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is,
my God, my God, my God,
there is freedom.
Just sing that one again, sing that one again.
There is freedom.
Somebody needs to declare that this morning. Yes, if you're tired
and you're thirsty, there is freedom.
Build it, come on. Freedom reigns.
Freedom reigns in this place.
Lord, we decree it.
Showers of mercy and grace falling on every face. There is freedom.
Hallelujah. Jesus reigns.
Jesus reigns in this place.
Hallelujah.
Showers of mercy and grace.
Jesus.
Heaven. There is freedom.
There's freedom here for you right now. Freedom for you.
We lift our eyes to heaven.
Hallelujah.
There is freedom.
Hallelujah. Let it rain. Let it rain right here.
Mercy and grace falling on every face. There is freedom.
Hallelujah. Give your all.
Give your all to Jesus. There is freedom.
Yes, Lord. Come on, church, give it all.
Oh, give your all to Jesus. There is freedom.
Come on, let it rain. Billy, right there, Billy. Come on, move.
Freedom reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace. Falling on every face, there is freedom.
Don't forget where that freedom comes from. Jesus! Woo!
Jesus reigns in this place. Showers of mercy and grace. Falling on every face. There is freedom.
Jesus reigns. Jesus reigns.
Jesus reigns in this place.
Showers.
Showers of mercy and grace. Falling on every face.
Press in a little deeper. Come on, press in a little deeper.
Showers of mercy and grace.
Yes.
Falling on every face.
Oh, there is
freedom.
Hallelujah. How many of you know that freedom? Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Freedom. Right here, right now. Come on. You don't need to wait another minute. There's a freedom here. There's a freedom here. We don't need to forget. Freedom is not just a thing. Like truth is not a thing. Truth is a person. And freedom is a person. If you've got Jesus, you've got freedom. Come on.
Come on. Just want you to shut your eyes and just sense His presence right there, right now.
I feel Jesus.
Oh God.
I feel Jesus.
Yes.
I feel Jesus.
He
is this place.
And yes,
my soul does burn within me.
Knew what had been happening, but they didn't know who was with him. Come on, guys. They were followers of that way, but yet they didn't realize Jesus was still with them. I want you to understand something. He's not sitting on that chair beside you, and He's not standing here next to you. If you're born again, He's living on the inside of you. I said He's living on the inside of you. You don't have to go somewhere looking for Him. Come on, He's right here. He's right here, right now. He's in the midst. Jesus.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hallelujah.
Go ahead and sing it.
I feel Jesus.
Yes, I do.
fullness is here for you if you'll partake of it. I'm your God. You are my children. I have picked you out of that world of darkness and shined the light of my glory into your hearts and lives. Walk and live in my light, saith the Lord. For I have called you, hallelujah to God. I have justified you, have I equipped you with every need you'll ever have. Look up this morning. My grace is sufficient and my power is present to avail in every area of your lives, hallelujah. For I am he that was dead, but I'm alive, and I'm alive forevermore. My living presence by my spirit is in you today, saith the Lord. Look up, reach up, and be filled with my presence this morning, saith the Lord. For it suffices in every area. My presence prevails over everything. My blood and my spirit, amen, gives you access to everything that you have need of, physically and spiritually, saith the Lord. I am here, my children. I am in you, and I live in you. You are my abode. You are my place of tabernacle. Do not doubt, but have faith in your hearts, the faith that I gave you, and walk in my light. And my light leads and guides you in the valley, on the mountain, in every area of your life. I am the Lord. I have given everything you have need of this morning. Hunger and thirst one more time, saith the Spirit. To see if my river, amen, will not flow into your innermost beings and out of you, not only to supply your needs, but the needs of those that come in contact with you. For when they meet you, they meet me. When they touch you, they touch me. For I am the Lord, my God. I am the Lord, and I prevail in every area, saith the Holy Spirit. Look not to the left, look not to the right, but look unto me, saith the Lord, and I will fulfill every promise and every word that I've ever spoken to you. For I am God, and I cannot lie. Men may lie, preachers may fall to the wayside, but I remain stable. I am the same forever and forever and forever, and I change not. Therefore, stability is here. The foundation of my word and the rock of my great power belongs unto you, saith the Lord. You're my living letters, my handwritten pages of a newspaper from the great press of heaven, that men may read and understand and know that you're mine and I'm yours, and there is a God in heaven, and there is a sonship and a fellowship and a possession, amen, of the great treasures of my love and glory. I love you, children. I love you, children. Look unto me. Look unto me and live, saith the Lord. Mountaintops, the valleys, the streams, even the desert is a place where I will flood with my presence, and you will be stable and suffice in every area, saith the Lord. Look unto me, saith God. Amen.
Look. Hallelujah. Come on. Message in tongues and interpretation. God is encouraging us to look to him. Come on, do that right now. Do that right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we look to you now. Oh God, we're not looking around. We're looking to you, Jesus. We're looking to you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 You know, that's from two different directions this morning. The Lord told me that in your desperation, don't make wrong decisions. The Lord is saying now, telling you where to go in this time of desperation. You need to look to Jesus. Come on. He's not a source, he's the source. Hallelujah. My God, my God, my God. Hallelujah. Father, go ahead. Come on. Lord Jesus. Jesus. I just keep hearing this. There's a door. There's a door that God has opened. Hallelujah. You're going to have to close that door that's of your own making, and you're going to have to go through the door that He's opened for you. Hallelujah. Don't make your own way. Don't make your own way. Thank you, Father. Oh, Jesus. Lord, you're the door to the sheepfold. There's an open door in heaven. Lord, you're about to call your church home. We realize, Lord, the time is short. We've got a work to do. So, Holy Spirit, we're trusting you. I trust you, Lord. I trust you, Jesus. Your integrity is impeccable. There's no shadow of turning. There's not a hint of unfaithfulness or double-mindedness in your will. So, Father, I trust you and I trust your word and I trust your purpose in my life. Come on. I trust you. Somebody just needs to tell him that. You need to say that out loud until you begin to really get your faith around it. God, I trust you. You're a trustworthy God. You are faithful. I've been unfaithful, but not you. Not you. You've never let me down. We sang it. It's in your word that there's no unfaithfulness in you, Lord. Your word is settled forever in heaven. There's no mistakes there. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah. Shata parana makitele beyana barondo bosoto forondo boshata. Gira baride bekesetele marondo bosha. Come on. Jesus. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for the man of God. Lord, I thank you for gifts that you're raising up all over this nation and in this region. Lord, ministry gifts that are, that Lord, you're plucking as brands from the fire. Thank you for this man of God. Lord, I pray over Isaiah this morning, Lord, that you meet every need that he and his family has. Wow. Isaiah, I'm reminded of the man that when Seymour went to California, Brother Parham sent two young men down this way and they landed here in Angleton, Texas. And the head preacher was up every night for several weeks preaching the baptism in the Holy Spirit, having never received it yet. But his faith had wrapped around it. And he preached and he preached and he preached. Though he had not received it, he knew it was truth. And he preached it. And one day coming back from a camp meeting on a train, God gloriously filled him. That he had embraced in his spirit finally became manifested in the flesh. And son, you have preached and preached and preached healing. Laid hands on your own daughter. You've asked and you've wondered. Don't cast away your confidence. God has not spoken yet. And when he does, everything aligns itself with his word. Hallelujah, Jesus. So son, keep preaching. Son, keep pressing. Keep moving. Eyes not seen, ears not heard. You haven't even begun to imagine what God's about to do. But he's deposited it within your spirit. So what's in your spirit, let it come out of your mouth. Release it. Release it.
says, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil upon the head coming down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard. That's why I keep a beard. Coming down upon the edge of his robes, it is like the dew of Hermon coming down upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, life and life forever. When I get to this place, that's the scripture that I always think of, the oil that is flowing here. And I just give honor and thanks to Pastor Brad and his wife for allowing me to be here. You know, whenever I was in the world, you know, a lot of y'all know my testimony. I come from a life of drug addiction and, you know, alcoholism. I had got hooked on cocaine at the age of 15. And so, right there. So, you know, when you're in that lifestyle, you start craving the good stuff, if that makes sense. Like, you ask around, hey, who has some of the good stuff? You know, not watered down, not cut, you know. Like, I need the pure stuff, you know. And because as a drug addict, you can tell the difference between the types of drugs. And it's the same thing about this place. You know, when you've encountered the glory of God, you want the good stuff, not the watered down stuff. And this church, the Lord was showing me, is going to be known around the nation as a glory hub, as a place that has the good stuff. I even see people flying all over just to get here. There's actually a word God gave me for this house. Shit, before we get into the message. Whew. I seen wind and rain whipping against this house, wave and wave trying to wash it away. But this is a house built on a firm foundation, and the onslaught that has came against it is being routed. And if a lot of y'all don't know, my education isn't that high. I only made it to half a semester, 9th grade, and then I dropped out and ended up, I always tell people I got a GED from the Texas Department of Education. Basically, the state of Texas gave me my GED in prison at 17. So I have to look up some of these words that God gives me, like even routed. You know, I'm like, what does that mean? And I want to share it with you. Routed means to defeat and cause to retreat in disorder. So the Lord is routing everything that has been coming against this church and the families of this church. Divine intervention is being released. And the morning as we're driving, it's an hour drive to get from Baytown here, I literally seen bombers in the air. And I had to look that up too. That's the word I heard. Bombers are in the air. And I was seeing airplanes, and that's literally what it is. That's something that is released to drop bombs upon ground targets. And the Lord said, the airstrike has been called in. The Lord has thundered and said, enough. Your season of suddenly is here. Daniel 2:21, it says, he changes times and seasons. He disposes kings and raises up others. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. I've heard the cry of my people, says the Lord. I want you to just say that with me. Your season of suddenly is here. Even the fact that I'm here is suddenly. Alex called me yesterday. He said, hey, I know it's short notice, but do you think you could come here in the morning? And that's when God began to... I've been hearing this word in my spirit for a while now, and God's just started giving confirmation suddenly. Throughout the Bible, it's always been suddenly. They were supposed to be waiting there for a promise of the Holy Spirit, and then suddenly, it sound of a mighty rushing wind began to invade that place. And what's so amazing is the one who was able to preach the sermon that morning was the one who just denied the Lord a couple of chapters ago. Well, you know, I don't know the time frame. And they said, you know the difference between Peter then and Peter now? He got filled. God will take ordinary and turn it into extraordinary. And the Lord is wanting to supercharge you this morning. I'm going to go to Isaiah 45. This is the second part of the word that he was showing me for this house. And it's funny, I have a funny story this morning. I went to this corner store to grab some mints. Yes. I think we've all been a victim of someone praying for us, right, without mints. And I try to be, courteous to others. So this morning I went to the corner store to get some mints, and I walked in, and the place is empty. And I'm like, okay, this kind of seems like a trap. Like, am I on one of those cameras where they're going to see if I'm trying to steal something? And I'm like, hello? Nobody's coming. I said, okay. I waited a couple minutes. I said, okay, this is weird. I said, let me try to leave and the door's locked. I'm like, okay, now it's like, it's 10:20. I'm fixing to have to preach. Please tell me I'm not fixing to be locked in this. I was like, and my wife is putting her makeup on. I'm fixing to call her like, you need to kick this door open or something. I'm stuck. And then the man finally comes out of the back room. He said, how you get in here? I said, what? He said, the door is locked. I said, I know it's locked. I tried to get out. He wouldn't let me out. He said, you just walked through a locked door. And then you catch that? And the Lord said, I'm about to open doors for you that no man can shut. And then he just said the same thing about the doors opening. Isaiah 45, thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held, to subdue nations before him and loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors so that the gates will not be shut. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gate of bronze and cut the bars of iron, and I will give you the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places. And we just declare that, Father God, in this morning over each one here in attendance, over this house, that you are giving them the wealth of the wicked, that you are opening the doors, that the airstrike has been called in, that there's more for us than is against us. Open our eyes, Father God. Just like you opened the eyes of the servant and he saw the chariots of fire. I thank you for the release of the chariots of fire that is being used to rout the enemies. The word says, bless the Lord, all you angels, you mighty ones, who wait to obey the voice of his word. There are angels that have been charged this morning in this place to obey and carry out his word concerning you. A lot of y'all know my testimony. The night before I was supposed to go to church for the first time in a long time, I had been in and out since I was little. I had first felt the Holy Ghost when I was 13 years old, and that's when all hell broke loose. Right? Funny. I got laid out. It was at this thing that Calvary did called Eruption. It was this play and show, and the fires came out, and the devil came out from the back, and I looked back, and I seen the devil, and I knew I needed to get saved at that moment because I didn't want him coming for me. But that's when everything got worse. Nightmares and waking up and feeling like something's choking me, and I realized that it only happened when I tried to go to church and read the Bible. So in my mind, I need to stay away from that thing. Something's happening to me. And I told my grandma, you know, I come from my mom's family. They're Hispanic and Catholic, and a lot of that is mixed in with religion and witchcraft. And I told my grandma, said, hey, man, this is happening every time I read the Bible. She said, you better leave that book alone. She said, my mama told me that thing would drive you crazy, and you got to stay away from it. I didn't know what was fighting for me at the time. Now I know. And I tell my wife, when that stuff tries out, nuh-uh, you got to get out of here in the name of Jesus. I ain't got time for you. And I'm hearing that this morning. The Lord is saying, some of you just got to say, I ain't got time for you. You got to go in the name of Jesus. I don't know about you. It's been hard. This past few weeks, specifically these past few months, it's been hard. I've been through some things that it's a cliche, new levels, new devils, but it's a very real thing. You're rising. And as you rise, you're not encountering those little imps anymore, those little foot soldiers. You're encountering some principalities, some municipalities, because God is raising you up to displace those principalities. And let's be real. I mean, this, America's under attack. I mean, they say they're not trying to push agendas on us, but everywhere you look, it's right there. I was reading, Anybody hear about the drag queen story hour? You go to the public library and a drag queen reads you a book. And these little kids are 5-6 years old, and they're saying, who wants to be a drag queen when you grow up? I do. And one little boy said, I want to be Superman. He said, what about Superwoman? You could be both. There's an onslaught. And there's a challenge this morning. The Lord said, are you willing to take the road less traveled? Are you willing to go against the grain? He's looking for one to just rise up and who will speak his words. John the Baptist was a sight to see, wasn't he? He came in looking contrary to what everybody thought. Right? Contrary to the fancy robes and everything. Whew. Was a young lady that was right here that delivered the message in tongues? Did I prayed for you last time too, huh? Can you come back up? Oh shit, the Lord said, "You are my John the Baptist." Oh shit, you are my voice in the wilderness, crying out, "Make straight the paths of the Lord." I've seen you like a precious diamond. And God has been refining you and purifying you for such a time as this. After I saw you as a diamond, I actually saw like an onion. And I saw layer after layer being removed. You've been asking for more. You surrendered to the call on your life. More, Daddy. Paul says, I long to see you so that I may impart some spiritual gift. And there's an impartation right now taking place of the prophetic in your life. Not only are you going to get messages in tongues, but you're going to get revelation. I see you writing. Spirit and what He wants to do. I actually got to go speak the other night, or I was one of the intercessors for an all-night prayer. And I got to pray at the 11th hour, and it was the subject I was covering was revival and spiritual awakening. And there was other people that, you know, it was a set of four different intercessors, and we got an hour, you know, to split between us, 15 or 20, however the Spirit led. And I, when it was my turn, you know, I maybe 5 minutes, and then He cut me off. And I said, I'm done. Because I know when the anointing has lifted and when it's there. And I never want to move without the anointing being there. Amen. The Lord said, you know, there's many, their sermon is 30 minutes, but I've only spoke 5 minutes. I said, wow. I said, Lord, please never let me be like that. And even now when I was speaking, I felt Him shift it. He said, I want to do this real quick. I want to stop. Because that's the God we serve. Amen. Divine interruption. Divine intervention. You think the woman at the well knew what was fixing to happen? She was just going to go get some water. And even they were on their way somewhere else too. And Jesus said, I need to stop here real quick. I need to make a divine intervention, a divine stop. And that's what's happening this morning. Thank you, Papa. There is a very, very strong anointing for healing in this place. Before He had released the word concerning my daughter, the Lord was already speaking to me about healing. If you have been battling any type of sicknesses or diseases, I don't care if the doctor says it's incurable or curable, whatever. I don't care if it's a little infection. I want to pray for you. God says the same comfort you receive, you can in turn turn and comfort others. My daughter, she's been battling since she was born. She was born with inguinal hernias, her ovaries pushed out, and all kinds of stuff. So immediately after she gave birth, she went into surgery for her ovaries and the hernias and all that. And we always knew there was something different about her. She didn't cry like the rest of the kids. And you can just tell, you know. And we went to get the doctor checked her out. And they came in and they told us that she had what's called Angelman syndrome, which is a very rare genetic disorder. It's like lightning hitting, and lightning decided to hit our house, right? And when the doctor told me that, all I heard was John chapter 9. The Holy Spirit said that, John chapter 9. And I didn't know off top what He was saying. So I had to go look it up, and it was when the disciples asked this Jesus, He said, who sinned? Was it this man or his parents that he was born blind? He said, neither sinned. This was allowed to happen so that the glory of God could be displayed in his life. And there's things that have been allowed to happen, not that God is causing it to happen, but He allows it so that the glory of God could be shown. How can we know that He is a healer until He heals us? How can we know that He is a provider until He is our only source of provision? Are you with me? And when He spoke that, there was peace that transpired. And the doctor was, you know, like trying to console us, like, it's okay. I mean, no, we're fine. We understand. I mean, I know it takes some time to process. Like, I guess they were expecting us to freak out and cry and scream. But the peace my God gives, it does not give as the world gives.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And they couldn't understand it. And it's been a battle. You know, when we first got saved, it seemed like every Sunday morning when it was time for church, she has a 105 fever. Or, you know, something is going on with her. And I'm relatively new in the faith, and all I'm doing is staying in this word, and I didn't even realize what I was doing to myself. Psalm 119, it says, how can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping it according to your word I have treasured in my heart, Lord, so that I shall not sin against thee. I didn't know what I was doing to myself. you put that much word in someone, it begins to transform them. I was making, I didn't realize what I was doing. Let me just say that. So 105 fevers are coming in the morning, and I'm praying, and I'm like, what do we do? What do we do? Do we take her to the hospital? I mean, if anyone knows what a 105 fever can do, they can fry the brain. And the Lord says, what does my word say? Well, if any amongst you is sick, to take them, call the elders of the church, anoint them with oil, and the prayer offered in faith, we'll heal that person. If a sin has been committed, they will be forgiven. Elijah was a man just like us, but he prayed fervently that it would not rain, and for 3 years it did not rain. And he said, the praise of a righteous person are effective and availeth much. And I'll tell my wife, hey, we got to go to the church. I mean, if they can't, if God can't heal it, no one can. If it's her time, it's her time. And so we would go, and they would pray. And, you know, I would sit during the sermon, and that leg is shaking, and I could hear I thought it was my thoughts, but I know it was the enemy. He was saying, you know, if her brain fries, that's on you. They're going to blame you. Your wife's going to leave you, this and that. And she said, you know what, let's go to the hospital. We got to go. I mean, we prayed. We tried that. I mean, it's 30 minutes in, and she's still burning up. And do you know, by the time we made it to the hospital, I never forget this. I looked at the time. It was right when the sermon was ending, and we walked in, and everything was back to normal. I said, if we would have just stayed till the end of the sermon. But when you're in those situations, it's scary because God's stretching you. And he's merciful, and he's understanding. You're going to slip. Like, I slipped. I doubted. I wavered. But he says, son, now you know. Now there's another level in your faith. And, you know, she doesn't get fevers like that at all. And something else she continued to battle was seizures. Very, very bad seizures. And, you know, I would come home. It always hit right after a victory. Come home seeing people healed left and right. And then she's going into a full-blown seizure. And, you know, it hurts. God, why? I stopped learning a long time. I learned a long time ago to stop saying, God, why? What's the purpose? What's the lesson? What are you trying to teach me? I need to learn so I can get through this. There's a reason the Israelites walked around the desert for 40 years. You know, it was only supposed to take, a week? What's the mountain that we're going around over and over again? God, what are you trying to teach us? And I'll never forget, one morning I was coming back from Houston. I had a training class out there, and it's about a 30-minute drive to get back home, and I'm soaring in the spirit, and I'm declaring the word, and God said, there's a breakthrough coming, and I'm, woo! You said it, so I know it's going to happen. I know the voice of my Father. And I get home, I said, baby, there's a breakthrough coming. I don't know what it is or how it's coming, but he said it's coming. There's a lot of things we were believing God for at that time. I said, at least one of the prayers are fixing to be answered. And I'm laying there taking a nap, and you know, I've been filling myself up. What you fill yourself up with is what's going to come out, right? I always tell people that. I see it all the time when I was working. You know, you got one man talking about sports, and he can recite all the stats and who won this, who won that. The other man is talking about the second job he has to go through and the new car he just bought, and overtime he's working. You can tell that sports and idolatry and entertainment is controlling his heart. And then the other man is wealth and mammon. And the other one's talking about this new girl that he met and the girl he was with last night and this other girl. Well, you know that lust and sex controls his heart. Because what you put in constantly is going to come out. And at this time, I mean, it's nothing but scriptures. I'm going to bed and I'm just quoting the word. And, you know, I'm falling asleep like that, actually quoting the word. And my wife's like, hey, before you fall asleep, go check on the kids. They were taking a nap. And I went in there and she was going into a full-blown seizure. She was asleep. And when it hits while they're sleeping, it's very hard for them to wake up. Some people don't wake up from that. You know, it gets really bad. And I'm like, you know, at this time, all I can do is just jump and scream, because me as, you know, a man, as a father, you know, if this was a physical person that was attacking my daughter, I'd tear him up, you know. But how do you fight something that is invisible? You know, how do you fight a sickness like this? And I just hit my knees and I'm, why, God, why? You just told me a breakthrough is coming. I don't understand this. And he said, there it is. You can't see it. It's right there. And she's going into a seizure. What do you mean? Do you know that when the epileptic kid went into his, was fixing to be healed. Right before he was healed, it threw him down into one of the worst convulsions he had, and then the Lord commanded it to leave. The Lord said, that's the last little bit of sickness that is there. I'm causing it to manifest so I can drive it out. And it's been over a year since she's had seizures. And she's not on medicine. The doctors don't understand that. My wife told him, she said, she hasn't had seizures in how long? Wow, that's amazing. How much of the medicine are we giving her? My wife said, I ain't giving her none. What, are you serious? Like, she started freaking out. She's like, you can't do that. I mean, seizures are something that comes along with her, you know, symptom, with her disorder. It's parallel. They go hand in hand. And my wife's like, no, she hasn't. It's been over a year. And, I mean, we're not giving her anything. She said, okay, well, what we're going to do is we're going to do some CAT scans and, you know, brain scans. And if she's showing any sign of this, then we're going to put her back on the medicine. And my wife said, okay, and if it's not, we're not going to give her any, right? And she said, yeah, I guess. And so I actually had to take her to the next doctor appointment. And she's like, yeah, the CAT scans are normal. Everything's fine. But we still no, you ain't recommending nothing. You already said, you gave your word, you can't go back on it. You, man might go back on it, but my God doesn't go back on it.
Yes, sir.
And I'm just believing this morning that that same anointing is going to be here. I remember when my mom first started coming to the faith, all these things started happening in her life. My little brother starts acting up. She starts having problems with her marriage. Just all this stuff started surfacing. And she said, why is this happening? I gave my life to the Lord. I said, that's why it's happening. All those things that you swept under the rug, all those things that you suppressed, all these things that you hidden, the light is shining upon it.
Come on.
And the rug is being pulled back. And God is causing it to come up so he can sweep it away. So if there's some things manifesting, that's a good thing, because God is getting ready to deal with it. I just want you to come to the altar if you're battling any type of sickness in your body. There's another lady, I was in Louisiana, and she called me. And when she called me, she said, my kidney's going septic, and I'm in a lot of pain. I have to go for surgery Tuesday, and I have kidney stones and all kinds of things. And she was back in Baytown. I was in Louisiana for a ministry. And I said, well, do you believe God can heal you? Because it ain't dependent upon me. I said, if we send the word, just like the faith of the centurion man, God's going to touch you, and you're going to know it's him, because I'm not there. It ain't me. And she said, I believe. And we started praying. It was me and Brother Donald. And she said, hey, I got a certain urge to go to the bathroom. I got to call you back. I said, okay, well, just I'll check on you Tuesday when it's time to go into surgery. And she called me. She said, hey, I went for the pre-op before they do surgery, and they said, there's nothing wrong with my kidney. The kidney stones are gone. And the doctor looked, and she said that your gallbladder's working perfectly fine, too. And she said, my gallbladder, y'all took that out a couple years ago. He said, I don't know what they took out, but it's right here. That's only God. Spirit of sickness, of infirmity, I command you to loose now in the name of Jesus. You have no power here. You have no authority here. We are blood-bought children of God. I see fire in your blood. I see fire cleansing your blood. I command all levels in your body to go to normal in the name of Jesus. I rebuke all cholesterol in the name of Jesus. I command every organ, every tendon. I command the heart to pump the way God intended it to. More. Your word says in John 14:12, really, truly, he who believes in you can do the same things we've done and even greater.
Yes, yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
More, Daddy.
Hallelujah.
More.
Yes, Lord.
I just want you to place your hand wherever it hurts, wherever the pain is. Daddy said he's about to release a corporate anointing for healing. And that the Holy Ghost is going to touch you. I believe you're my healer.
Hallelujah. I believe. Come on.
I believe you're my healer. I believe you're more than enough for